so excited when it's time to do this podcast. so happy. Thank you for joining us once again on Worship Gist with Vashti. Beautiful time where we just sit down here and just worship related gist. And when we are done, you guys ask us the questions you want to ask us on YouTube or other platforms, and we try to answer the ones that we can answer. But we hope that all other editions that we have had, you guys had a nice time and picked a few things from what we said. If we said anything wrong, please tell us. We like the feedback.
Yeah.
So you're welcome to Worship Gist with Vashti and Femi. My name is Pastor Femi Ndagana. Did I say Pastor Femi Ndagana?
I was wondering.
Oh God, what happened?
He wants to do the pastor vibes in this edition. That's fine.
And here with me, as usual, is my one and only beautiful, world class.
Always add that.
Tomato Jones.
Hey, good. Hi. Nice to have you.
Pastor Vashti.
Nice to have you all here again. Don't mind my husband. Don't mind him. It's Worship Gist with Femi and Vashti.
Wherever.
I always say that. Wherever. Thank you for joining us again. We hope you have a wonderful time. Don't mind this man. Let's proceed.
All right. Thank you for joining us. It's been a nice time having this program with you. And this is the March edition of the monthly podcast where we discuss about worship-related topics and other topics that have to do with the music ministry. Is it music ministry or music industry now?
Ministry.
That's another topic for another day.
Yeah.
One day we'll come and discuss whether music ministry or music industry or music ministry. So we'll discuss that some other day. All right, but today we're going to be talking about something very, very special. Please don't forget to follow us on social media platforms on YouTube, SoundCloud, Instagram and Facebook, and everything we have, all our videos, all our songs, you find them there and you'll be blessed.
Did you talk about Boomplay and AudioMac?
Yes, all other music, online music platforms, we have our songs there. But for the videos, you find them on YouTube, on Instagram, and on Facebook. All right, so today we're going to be talking about something very, very interesting, something very, very dear to my beautiful wife's heart. It's something that she loves so much, and she gets into fights with music directors and with choir leaders on this issue. And that is why I think there is no other person that will discuss this thing and give us in-depth knowledge about it than my beautiful wife, Pastor Vashti. And what we're talking about today is the power of spontaneous worship. At some point, you would think my wife's name is spontaneous. Because every time we're having any of our editions, anytime we're having any ministration, she always says, me, I want this thing to be spontaneous. And you find out that she have quarrel with a music director, Emily. It's always quarreling with Emily.
Emily, I love you.
And Ewa.
Sugar.
Always having quarrels with them because they always want it to be planned, rehearsed, let it go like this. But she always says, no, spontaneous. Now let's go. What is the meaning of spontaneous worship? What is spontaneous worship?
Worship that just comes, an impulse.
Okay.
No serenity. Those do it two times, one time. It just comes as the spirit leads. In fact, that's the word. They know every time they hear Vashti, then she will come and say, as the spirit leads.
And they'll be looking at you as if which kind, this one, know they two.
She not only you spirit,
only
they,
you spirit
lead.
They talk to.
Which two spirit they lead us now?
Nah, they careful. Anybody they think that one. Now, so Miriam tell Moses, say, now only you got they talk to. I know what you have to follow. Yes, ma'am. So you mean spontaneous worship is the kind that is actually unplanned?
Yes.
And comes in the moment.
You just, it's not planned. Then it helps you to just express yourself as the Holy Spirit helps you and gives you inspiration.
Okay, how is it different from the traditional? How is it different from the traditional format of worship? How is spontaneous worship different from the normal planned rehearsed? Well, how is it different?
Okay, it's different in the sense that you are really not in control of yourself.
Okay.
You are fully, fully dependent on the leading of the Spirit of God.
Okay.
When you are doing worship, because it's not planned. Okay, I would like to use a scenario. I'm a baker by profession, and I know that if there's one person who talks about measurements when it comes to baking, that's me. That's my rule. Whether for cooking, for doing anything, I just believe that if you have measurement for these things, you will get it, no matter who you are. Now, listen. You, no matter who you are, once I give you the measurement and I say follow these steps, and you follow it, it comes out very, very well. But there are times in my profession that I just go to my studio and I just say, today we're going to bake as inspired by the Holy Spirit. Yes. So we sit down, I just tell my girl, okay, give me 2 eggs, give me 2 cups of flour, give me 1 cup of oil, give me this, give me that. Honestly, at that point that I'm talking to her, it's not me that is talking. Because even me that is saying it, I don't know what I am saying. But I will give all this and I say, let's try. If it comes out fine, glory to God. If it doesn't come out well, we'll learn our lesson. But at the end of the day, there's something to learn, whether good or bad. And we do it. And most times, those cakes come out very fine. Mm. And I just give it one name. I said, that's the recipe. Mm. You understand? Now, that's in cake now. Mm. I'm likening it to that. Yeah. When it comes to worship, yes, we have the traditional worship that I talk about, the planned one in churches. And those ones, for me, it's easier when it's a choir piece.
Mm-hmm.
When
it's a choir rendition.
Yes, it's a choir rendition, something like a hallelujah chorus.
Okay.
You understand? You can't come and you're supposed to be singing hallelujah, hallelujah, and you just come and read it, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You are destroying something.
There's a pattern.
There is a pattern, and you will follow it, yes. But when it comes to spontaneity in worship, you are helpless without the Holy Spirit. So you just depend on the Holy Spirit as it comes. And sorry to say, it's not based on feelings, because sometimes we tend to mix it.
Mistake feeling, yes, for the Holy Spirit.
We mistake feeling for the Holy Spirit. So I feel like, I've listened to this song. Ah, Sumi Sola sang this song. It's so nice. So I'm going to do it. Ah, the way she bring this.
You
bring
think
this,
so you bring, go create that same, yes, environment and this
and
thing.
Everything. And maybe because of the way you saw people responding to the song and everything. So you too, you now say, okay, let me do it. Or Sheva, she sang this song yesterday in this meeting. And you know, the power was so strong, so I'm going to sing this song too, so the power is strong. It doesn't work that way.
Mm.
It's the Holy Spirit who directs you and instructs you, and as you hear, you release.
So in the planned worship, there are usually pre-selected songs.
Yes.
Songs, and this is the one that's going to go after this, this one that's going to go after, that's the planned one.
Not
and,
just selected songs.
And the rehearsal, yes, the beat,
the arrangement of the songs.
How many times,
yes,
the lead does this one, and then the vocals coming. That's in worship. We're not talking about...
it has intro.
We're not talking about renditions. Yeah. So we're talking about worship.
Yeah, yeah.
Worship. So the planned one, everybody knows. In fact, musicians, instrumentalists, they prefer this planned one because they can plan out an intro that they will do. Moscow
P.
They can spend hours on doing that intro.
Yeah.
Plan out how the intro will go, and then in the middle of the song, if there's going to be an interlude, they already know what they're going to do. That's when it's a planned one. So I try to tell me that in spontaneous worship, there are no pre-selected songs. Are there pre-selected songs?
There are.
Okay.
There are. Okay. I'll say I like to use myself a lot as example, because that's where my strength is. What I normally do is that I'll just pick one or two songs as my start song. So I'll let the musicians know.
So every time the music directors
calm down now, let me talk.
Ask you for your list of songs.
Wait, you... now I'm getting there. I'm getting there.
I'm sorry.
So I just pick one or two songs, and I'll tell them that this is the song that I want to start with.
Mm.
So we rehearse based on that and then leave it at that. But I have some very wonderful people in my life that will say, Mama, give us your lineup of songs.
Mm.
Nothing like spirit lead. Let us rehearse. Let us know what and what.
Mm.
I don't used to argue with them because I realized that those times I used to argue, we end up arguing and arguing, and maybe we end up offending ourselves. So in order to avoid offense, I will just respect them and send them the lineup. Sometimes they even tell me, no, it's not like this. The arrangement, you know, I say, it's okay, it's fine.
Say the truth and shame the devil. That lineup usually is too
late. Wait now. I said, this man, you're in a rush. Don't be in a rush. Now you see, what actually happened, like in the last worship altar we had, that's February, we had a song, a start song, right? I think we rehearsed up to like 5 songs. Since my music director wants a lineup, I gave him. So we rehearsed. But when I got there, because there was someone that was leading before me, and really at that point that the person was leading the song before I came up, the song had already preached many of the things that God had already revealed to me about the worship for that month.
Mm.
So I flowed in that song.
Okay.
I didn't just go to the song that I was supposed to sing. Mm. I flowed and ministered in that song.
That was spontaneous.
And I if I remember, maybe in the songs that we rehearsed, maybe it was just one that I did.
Wow.
Every other one was as the Holy Spirit was releasing it to me. That's how I did the song. So it's not to do a spontaneous a song. It's not a matter of feeling. It's a matter of what the Holy Spirit is saying at that particular time concerning a particular situation. Sorry, sir. There are times that you prepare for a ministration. You know, you prepare for a ministration and the Holy Spirit is revealing to you the things that are going to happen, are likely to happen in that ministration. He's telling you about the kind of people that are coming for that ministration, if possible, their needs at that time. So you have to be very, very sensitive to hear what the Holy Spirit is saying.
Yep.
What are the needs of your audience at that point in time? As the Holy Spirit is revealing to you, when you allow the Holy Spirit to now take lead, as you stand to lead the people in worship, He begins to release songs. He begins to release instructions concerning the people that are there. And the day that the Holy Spirit decided that, no, this one, it is you and God. Every other person will connect. The Holy Spirit will still direct you on how to go about it. So while I'm not saying that I'm not trying to say that do not arrange your songs or plan your songs. No, that's not what I mean. But what I'm trying to say is that make room always for the Holy Spirit.
Don't be too dependent on yourself.
Don't be too rigid. And say, no, it has to be 5 times.
Mm-mm.
You know, there are songs.
Structure.
Exactly.
Mm.
There are songs that you do. And apparently you have arranged that you're going to do it 2 times. Then you do the verse. Then 2 times. Then you do the vamp. Then 2 times. Then you end it. And that's the end of the song. You say, okay, that ministration is going to be 5 minutes.
Mm.
And that day, the Holy Spirit might be asking that ministration is going to be for 15 minutes.
Mm. Mm.
Someone came to church for that purpose. And you refuse to do it because you are following arrangement and what you have done. You have denied that person of what God has for him or her because you are trying to be structured and trying to do what you feel it's okay. While I know that there is the place of discipline, but when the Holy Spirit is giving instruction and it is clear to you that it's the Holy Spirit, especially when you know that the time allocated to you will accommodate that, please give room to the Holy Spirit. Don't fight him.
You know, there's at those points that you hear people say that the spirit of the prophet is subject to the prophet. But the truth is that when the Holy Spirit wants to take control, when the Holy Spirit, in fact, you find out that the congregation, the people, their needs are being met by the Holy Spirit. They wouldn't want it to stop.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You find out that whoever is supposed to minister in the world, if he's supposed to come after that, they wouldn't even want to alter what is happening.
Mm-hmm.
Like in the last, you will tell us about that later, but spontaneous moments always make the atmosphere to feel real.
Yeah.
And I that's what
it's
what
not mechanical.
That's the next thing I wanted to actually ask you, but I feel like talking about it a bit. Spontaneous, what is the, you seem to be so much of an advocate for spontaneous worship.
Mm.
And I feel you think there's some power in it that you could get more than in the planned one. We're not saying that there's no power in planned worship, but most of the times when the worship is planned, okay, you say you're doing it 2 times the verse, 1 time the chorus, then the choir comes back to do this one, then we'll now do a call and response, and then we're finished. Sometimes when you're done, it becomes empty. because you went by the book and you are done. You don't know what to do again, especially when it's administration you are doing, you're leading people into worship before the preacher comes up.
Mm-hmm.
You find out that you guys are done with your structure and you don't know what to do again. And because you have said no spontaneity, it is strictly by structure. When you are done with the structure, you now find yourself lost. And the congregation will be looking at you. They're expecting more from you. The Holy Spirit wants to work, but you are trying to limit the work of the Holy Spirit. So refusing to be spontaneous is like refusing to allow the Holy Spirit to move. Nobody said the Holy Spirit cannot move through planned worship, but it's like refusing to allow the Holy Spirit to move because you want to go by your own structure and by your plans. It must go by the book. So you being an advocate for spontaneous worship, what advantages, what tangible advantages does it bring in worship?
Spontaneous worship makes room for you to receive more from God. It makes room for you to connect to the heavens easily. You understand? Okay, you are singing a song and you hear it clearly that this particular line of this song, stay there. Stay there. Do not move.
That is spontaneous.
And as you are staying there, see, you don't need to say any other thing, just that line. You don't even need to lay hands on anybody. The Holy Spirit is already going and doing the work. Because when you hear that word, stay there, it means that there is a ministration that is about to go on within the congregation. And
that, it has to do with that line.
It has to do with that line. So you stay there, if possible, if you have spent time in the place of prayer and study of the word, the Spirit begin to release passages to you on that particular line that you are instructed to stay on, and you can begin to minister with that line. And people are receiving their breakthrough, they are receiving their miracles.
And that staying on those particular lines, I never rehearsed.
No, how can you rehearse?
They are never rehearsed.
How can you rehearse that?
They never. You never. Maybe sometimes in rehearsals, it depends on how your rehearsals are. Maybe sometimes in rehearsals where you guys just allow the rehearsals to flow. Allow the Holy Spirit to
that's
flow
just spontaneity.
That's
rehearsals.
Being spontaneous in rehearsals. But do you know something? The way the Holy Spirit works, the way you guys did in rehearsal may not be the same way He wants you to do it when you come to minister it.
But permit me to add, sir, that much as spontaneous worship is very important, I'll still talk about other advantages of spontaneous worship. But much as it is important, you cannot do spontaneous worship if you have not rehearsed that song that you want to sing. Yeah. Because I saw one I saw one video, you are crazy. Yes, you are. Yeah. Only long. I really don't know what that lady was singing. Yes, I really don't know what she was singing, but it was just somehow. You understand? So if you don't know a song, how can you be spontaneous with that song? It's only when you know the song and the song has meaning to you that you can now use it for spontaneous worship. So rehearsals is important. Scoring the song and understanding the arrangement of the song is very, very important. Now, by the time you do that, then you can now apply it to spontaneous worship. It now becomes very easy. Now, I won't shy away, because the truth is that we grow every day. So I won't shy away from the fact that there are times that some songs I really didn't know them very well. Probably I didn't know the lyrics, but that's when we started. But I didn't understand the arrangement and where I'm supposed to come in or not. So I end up sometimes missing beats, sometimes entering too quickly or entering late like that. And gradually I kept on growing. I think I've said it here before. I kept on growing, becoming better and better. So it's only when you understand those rudiments, then spontaneity becomes very easy for you. Now, another advantage of spontaneous worship is that it helps to involve your audience in it. Because if you are about two times, one time, this is how it should be, your audience want to sing. Your audience want to join you in worshiping God. They want to worship their maker. But the driver that is driving them is taking them to where they don't know. And because of that, you just...
Help me out.
Can you hear me? Can I go on? Okay. Sorry for the break.
No, it's just
so, as I was saying, it's...
It just cuts them off.
It just takes them off.
The worst thing that can happen to you as a music minister during ministration is for your congregation to be completely off, to be cut off guard and disconnect from the worship. It will lead to frustration. You will get tired. You will start getting unnecessarily angry because everybody is not in tune with what you are doing. So you end up, when you come down, you start blaming musicians, start blaming backups, start saying the churches are not even responding. They just stand like standing stick and what have you. But when you know what you are doing and you have the backing of the Spirit, see, you don't need to struggle. See, you don't even need to tell people, let's be on your feet. You don't need to tell them.
Very, very true.
There is a spirit that will catapult them from their seats.
When there's a leadership of the Holy Spirit, you don't need to tell people to stand up.
You don't need to. They will respond.
The Holy Spirit will stand them up.
Yes. It will catapult them from their seat with so much fire that they will not even know what is controlling them. So, spontaneous worship helps the congregation to build intimacy with God in the place of worship. Because at that point, everybody is connecting to God directly. It's not even a function of you, because you are just being used by the Holy Spirit. While you are connecting, they are also connecting. It becomes very, very easy. At that point, network is good. So connection is very easy. But you see, when there's no network during worship, my brother, MTN will even be better. MTN, I'm sorry.
Yes. Spontaneous worship brings some kind of freshness. You know, something that is fresh, something that has not been heard or seen before. Remember one time that you were doing one of the monthly editions?
Mm.
There was this song, Reckless Love, that we're doing. And there's a part that you just started saying, "You love me so recklessly. He loves
the song." Spontaneous worship makes the song you're singing to make meaning.
It becomes real.
To you. Yes.
It becomes
your reality. It enters you.
It's fresh. There is authenticity. It makes it authentic. You know, if it's something that has been done before, if it's a song that has been done before and you just score it and come and sing it, some people in the congregation can even score it better than you.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You understand? What you are doing is something they know. They know that this is the next thing you're going to do because you scored it exactly.
But in spontaneous, you're unpredictable.
They can't predict what you are doing because you can't predict the Holy Spirit.
You can't.
It's just like this podcast now. I'm sure you guys know that this podcast is spontaneous. We do not sit down and draw a script and say, babe, when you say this one, and I say this one. After I say this one, when I say this one. No, it's purely spontaneous, natural, and authentic. That is how spontaneous worship is very, very authentic, fresh, and
there are people
natural.
In the Bible that also did spontaneous
worship. Yes. There are three places I can mention now in the Bible
spontaneous
where there was spontaneous worship. First time, when David was taking the ark into the city of David.
Mm-hmm.
Remember when he was dancing in front of the ark, when Michal said,
"Yes, that's the way he was almost naked."
That was because if it was rehearsed and if it was planned, David would have worn his crown and worn his gown
and regalia.
Yes.
And then there are men following him, so he cannot do anyhow. But at that point, I want to imagine like, that he was singing, "Not me, sir, they praise."
Oh God!
Now God had a praise.
Where's Brother Solo?
I think that was what you were singing.
Worship is not only singing. You remember we have said it before?
Yes.
Worship
can
be dancing.
Yes.
So it can be spontaneous dancing.
I'm telling you.
So that was a spontaneous worship moment where David was able to successfully move the Ark of Covenant to the city of David. Then the other time was when the people of Judah were besieged by those three kings. Ammon, Mount Seir, and what's the name of the other one? Those three kings. And then God just told them, "Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord." And he told them that just go out and just appoint singers to sing. Those people did not rehearse for singing. Those people did not prepare for singing. They prepared for war. And so if there was anything that they had planned or rehearsed for, was to fight.
Yeah.
Well, God says, "You guys are going to sing." So they came out there, no rehearsal, and they sang worship unto the Lord. And because of that, those three kings started killing themselves.
Gee, that was one of the songs they were singing was, "Your good that and your mercy endureth forever." That was
the power of spontaneous worship. Then the third one, if you ever tell me that this will rehearse, then I think something is wrong with you. Paul and Silas. When Paul and Silas were in the prison, after they are being flogged and they were chained, did they rehearse the songs that they sang? They didn't. It was spontaneous. They allowed the Holy Spirit to minister through them. And the administration broke chains. It broke the prison gates. And it even brought salvation to the soul of the prisoner.
In fact,
and
his family. There was no instrument.
Mm-mm.
Sometimes I think we need to let go of instruments. And that's why I think the places where we get inspiration more is in our room, where we are clapping our hands and we are singing to God. Sometimes we need to leave the drum, leave the keyboard, leave everything. Let's just praise God.
No, but you know those things used to add.
No, I'm talking about personally. Okay. Personally, in your closet, you understand? It helps you to connect well with God. If you have a keyboard, fine, play it, but just need to be calm and quiet and receive from God.
Okay, Ma, please now. You know, you're like I said at the beginning of this, you are our subject matter expert.
Oh, shit.
You're our SME on this. So please, can you give us a practical one example, your life experience you have had about the power of spontaneous worship?
Plenty.
Tell us something quite recent. Something.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, we had an impromptu kind of worship.
You mean the worship night?
Yes, okay, in church. Okay. A few days ago. And we were like, are we going to do it? Are we not going to do it? And pastor insisted that we have to do it. So we already know that we have to do it. And my darling Oga, my MD said, send lineup. And honestly, at that point, I didn't even have any lineup in my head. I was just praying and asking the Holy Spirit to help us, to minister through us and to glorify himself. And when he said send lineup, I now shall send two. But meanwhile, before the service, before the worship, in church, I just heard the Holy Spirit during the message, I think first service, the Holy Spirit just said, write down these songs. So I wrote it down. In my mind, all I was thinking of was that the Holy Spirit wanted me to prepare maybe for the worship altar or against Easter.
Okay.
So I was just writing for writing's sake. But when he asked me to send lineup, as instructed. Yes. So when he asked me to send lineup, I just sent two. Like, let me just send. And he was like, only two. The rest is led by the Spirit. But I laughed because as usual.
Sorry to cut you. This spirit you have been saying, are you trying to indirectly tell us that as a music minister or as someone that worships God, if you cannot hear the Spirit, then you may be doing nothing?
Yes, you may be wasting your time. In fact, it's not me. You are wasting your time.
Oh.
You are wasting your time. Because to worship him in spirit.
Because the way you keep talking about the Spirit, as if it's one friend of yours that you have.
Yes, is he not our friend? What is this?
Holy Spirit, my best friend.
So he's our friend. The Holy Spirit is our friend. He teaches us all things.
True.
That's what the Bible says in John chapter 14. He says he will send us a helper, the Holy Spirit, who will teach us all things.
So in church, at
everywhere,
home, we should listen to the Holy Spirit.
In your workplace, everything. You know, the reason why many people don't build relationship with the Holy Spirit is because they feel that the Holy Spirit is not close to them. There is something they need to do, like, he's one kind of strange being like
it's
this.
Holy Ghost. It's Holy Ghost. It's Holy Ghost.
Okay, so that Holy Ghost. Ooh. But is he still small? That still small voice you hear. He's there with you. He's the one telling you, Vashti, no, don't do it this way. I know this is how you feel. You want to do it this way, but you can't. Leave it this way. Okay, yes, they are annoying you here. But can you calm down?
When you refuse to hear, you regret it.
You regret it. And one good thing about the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit will not come and say, I told you so. He will still allow you to still soak everything. Then you will come back again. He will now teach you again. Oh yeah, do it this way now. And the more you keep disobeying, the more you keep finding yourself in plenty busy. So I was saying, I now wrote those songs. So when he was asking me, when I gave him the songs, we started arguing. And he said that that the lineup of the song is not too okay. There will not be smooth transition. I said that is where there is a place of rest in music. Like, at the end of the day, I just told him, just allow the spirit to lead. So when we came, honestly, I don't even know what I wanted to sing. I know that I've given a lineup, but I didn't have an idea of what I wanted to sing. But immediately I went up, because I was already deep into the worship, from the first person that came to the second person. And when I went up, the only song that I could write is Yahweh, Yahweh. Where would I be? Even the other one I gave, I did not sing it. And then the Holy Spirit now reminded me, those songs
that you were writing,
this is the moment.
Wow.
In my mind, first of all, the song is him. Like, him? How? You understand? But
doesn't seem like what's in vogue.
No, at all. It was not a...
trending.
Yes, kind of. But it was, much as it was strange, but I found myself singing it. And the Holy Spirit collected the thing from my hand and did what he wanted to do. You understand? So if I had insisted and like, because... at some point, I was beginning to feel pressured to just...
She's glossing over it. The Holy Spirit actually did what he wanted to do. Because the Holy Spirit took us to another level that day. I could see a lot of people, young people, old people, praying and deep. You see that thing you mentioned at the beginning, that spontaneous worship helps us to create an intimacy with God. I could see many people being so intimate with God in that moment. And so practically, I can say, yes, spontaneous worship brings that intimacy. It helps the manifestation of the fruit and the gifts of the Spirit in our lives. And we could see the manifestation of the works of the Spirit. It's in atmosphere of spontaneous worship that you even get messages from God.
Yeah.
Because in that worship, we got a message from God. God spoke to us directly. In that worship, the pastor came up and, you know, when they said the musicians ministered, and when the ministers came up, the priests came up, they could not do any ministration
because
the place was so dense with the cloud of glory. That's what actually happened. That's what spontaneous worship does. It creates a cloud of glory that makes it difficult for you to do anything else. And in that atmosphere, healing, deliverance, freedom, people just start receiving unction. The people that were receiving manifestation, speaking in tongues, it just came in that moment. And that's what spontaneous worship does. In as much as we do not want to underestimate or undermine the place of planned worship, but there's so much advantage in spontaneous worship that individuals, churches, choirs, groups should latch onto and hang on to.
I like the last point you made. Churches should latch onto it. Not to come for any church whatsoever, but I think it's important that churches give room and enough time for people to worship God and connect with God. But I realize that most times we're in a hurry, you know, we have this to do. So we're very fast. Okay, I accept. If it's a service that is structured, fine. But can churches create more avenues where people can come to worship God? I know we have the worship altar where we call people to worship God. There are other worship altars that are being raised everywhere. Some people do it monthly, some people bi-monthly,
some weekly.
You understand? Some people do it twice a year. Mm. But whatever opportunity you get to worship God, please do it. And churches too, much as your members may not be able to go to different places to worship, create an atmosphere of worship in the church, you know, so that people are able to connect on a one-on-one and a personal level with God. And what does that do? It does not only build the people, it also builds the choir in the church and builds the worship team. And then it brings about an atmosphere of the Holy Spirit. It's very easy for people to hear God, very easy for people to receive from God, very easy for people to build intimacy with God without you saying anything to them.
And the truth, when I was thinking about this the power of in spontaneous worship, I realized that most of the songs that we score, we do planned rehearsal, and we score and say we want to go and do it. Those people did not actually, those people were spontaneous.
Yeah.
What they actually did was spontaneous, and we are now trying to score their spontaneity and do it
as planned.
Most times you see, like, okay, when Dusin was singing What song was that? That he did Bashiga.
When I said the blood of Jesus.
Jesus, the blood and the name. Yeah. That Bashiga, like, as far as I'm concerned, I don't know, I stand to be corrected, but it sounded spontaneous. Yeah. When Nathan Abasi and what's this other guy? What's this guy that married?
McDowell.
McDowell and Travis Green.
Yeah.
When they did You Are God
and we worship.
That dun 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 dun. I believe it was spontaneous.
You know, that's
most
what
of
I'm
those
saying,
things
that
are spontaneous.
It might be a structured ministration or maybe live recording or what have you. But what those people did was that they were not too rigid to hinder spontaneity. So there was a transition.
They created a
a smooth transition from the structured
balance.
One to the spontaneity. So there was a balance. Everybody was blessed. You understand? So they were not rigid. I think the point here is that we should avoid all manner of rigidity when it comes to
worship.
Allow the Holy Spirit to lead. Even if you have a structure, allow the Holy Spirit to lead. Joshua, don't give me 5 minutes here, please. Allow the Holy Spirit to lead and let him do what he wants to do.
Beautiful, beautiful. So what are some challenges that can be faced? What are some challenges with spontaneous worship? There are some challenges.
Yes.
So what are some challenges that musicians face when engaging spontaneous worship? What are the things, risks that are wrong?
Okay. It can affect their self-esteem.
Yeah,
confidence. When a musician has not really rehearsed that song, or he has not scored that song before, yes, it can just put them off, and they'll begin to look for you. That's when you see him doing 1, 4, 3, 2, like that. So they are trying to get it, and you know, because of that, it can also dampen the atmosphere.
Yeah.
So if you don't really know how to transit very well, it can just mess everything up. So, is it safe to say that spontaneity also requires some
expertise?
Yes, it does.
The onus now is on the worship leader. Because whether you like it or not, you need to carry everyone along.
But
your backups, the musicians, and the congregation, you need to carry them along in being spontaneous. So as much as the Holy Spirit is leading you, the way the Holy Spirit leads you, you need to carry the people along in that direction. And what ways do you carry people along? Teach them. There's a way you'll be able to teach them what you want to do. They understand. Make it easy for them to be able to latch into it and understand it. Give the musicians opportunity to be able to learn what they are trying to do at that time. You understand? Don't get angry with them when they are not getting it.
And don't go and bring someone that has 15 lines. You don't do that in spontaneous
Exactly.
Worship.
In spontaneous worship, when the Holy Spirit leads you, it's your duty now to be able to carry everybody along in that worship. Sometimes you can just get your backups lost. You can now bring up a song that they don't know. And you see backup one will be trying to do as if he knows it, be looking for the lyrics on the screen. If there's no lyrics, you just drop the mic and start speaking in tongues. So the onus is on the worship leader to be able to carry everybody along. And there are one other thing before you say other the challenges with it. I'm sure Joshua is going to give me a bottle of Coke after I say this. When most worship leaders go spontaneous, they make the media to be lost because the lyrics that they were supposed to project so that everybody is carried along is not there.
Joshua is clapping.
The lyrics is not there.
Yes.
So how do you carry the people along? That's why the onus is on you. In being spontaneous, it has to be simple enough for people to understand. It has to be simple enough that the media will not even feel lazy or feel frustrated not to type it. Because if they are flowing and the Spirit catches the people, they will type it there quickly and just give it to you. Understand?
Yes.
So the onus is on the worship leader to carry everybody along, but there's so much power. Yes, other challenges.
I like the simplicity you talked about. Let's get practical here. You are leading a song and you are led to bring in another one which is not in the lineup and not part of the arrangement. It's important that it's very short and easy to learn. When it's short and easy to learn, it makes it smooth. So you can bring something like I love you forever. I love you forever. I love you forever, Lord.
That's all.
It becomes easy for people to learn. Before you finish teaching, media has already typed it.
Damn.
And they're already projecting it. Musicians are already together. So 2-3 times you teach it, everybody is good, and then you move.
And you know, when you're spontaneous, you actually dwell on a particular line. So in that time of dwelling, it's not the one that that's not spontaneous again. Not that one you do it 3 times and then you now change. Media was trying to type you and now change. You now just give up. Say, anything we
want,
make it.
Or you want to go and
just they do,
Themselves. Ah. You now say, no, I'm going to, in the midst of worship. That's indiscipline. And this is the confidence that I have in you, that when I ask nothing, you just start seeing people sitting down one after the other. It's a good song,
yes.
It's my song, but they start sitting down one after the other because like, what is this? We're already in the spirit. This person now dragged us with force
trying to teach a song and don't break the flow.
You understand? So spontaneity requires expertise. Don't be quick to change song. Don't sing 30 songs in 2 minutes. You're not a miracle worker. I keep saying it. Don't sing 30 songs in 2 minutes. Sing one song and dwell there. Dwell there and allow it to sink in the heart of people. Then you help the people to worship. Another challenge again of this spontaneous worship is that if you, the worship leader, does not know the word of God, you don't have a prayer altar, you don't spend time to rehearse, you don't do vocal warm-ups, you now want to do spontaneous, devil will disgrace you. He will disgrace you like that. You will sing first, you will sing on many keys, then your transition will be from eating beans to taking it with amala and boiled egg and fried yam.
One of my colleagues in the office said this can be likened to breeze blow. I will not complete it. And then something open.
Yes.
Because you'll be exposed.
You'll be exposed.
That would be your breeze blowing moment.
Because it's just like I said, your spontaneous worship requires you to know what you are doing at every time. You can have 3 songs that have 3 different beats, but you can transit smoothly on those songs if you know what you are doing. If you have the word of God, at some point you will stop, which is called a rest, and then admonish the people.
Yeah, minister.
Allow the instrumentalists to be able to gather themselves and everything. Then slowly bring in the next song, and then you pick it up again, and then you get to another point, take a break again like that. That is how spontaneous worship is. And all these things, truly, truly, if the Holy Spirit is not backing you up, if you don't have the word of God, if you don't have what it takes, you will just be disgraced. Just stay in your rehearse something. 2, 5, 3 times, end it.
The truth is that spontaneous worship also, it becomes easier if, like you said, you need to have a prayer altar, you need to have a good
word knowledge.
Another thing you need to have is the purpose. What's the purpose of that service? You can't be in a communion service and you're trying to be spontaneous on something that is off communion, off the message of communion.
But sir, this matter of communion, where you talk, let's settle something here. No.
Sister,
let's break one table.
I don't know why I brought this.
Sir, No, we'll scatter this table now. Joshua, please bear with us. We're going to round up soon. But please, let's scatter this table. Now, I want to say something, sir. I've had to argue with some of my people on this. You go for a communion service.
The blood of Jesus.
And then the only song that we know for communion is "The blood of Jesus set me free." Or you start singing "Bread of Life, send down from glory. Many things you wear on at a holy place. You want to live." They are good songs. I don't have a problem with it. But every communion has a purpose. Every communion has a purpose. If this is a communion for preservation, while you sing the blood of Jesus set me free from sin and sorrow,
connect,
please, can you sing something like "I am saved, whatever may betide me"?
Connect it to the preservation,
to
yeah,
the theme.
Yeah.
It now makes it easy and helps even the pastor to make his messages smooth.
Yeah.
Or they say that we are anointing you for breakthrough, and then the only song that you as a minister, as a worship leader, sings is anointing fall on me.
But it shows that you're
the power of the
it just shows that you're not in tune and you're not following.
Yes, because if you are following, you will hear the message. You hear, yes, it will be very easy for you to transit.
Yes,
but if you're not following, so please, I beg, what are they do communion for church? Not be every time we not just one song. We will not know because they say in a communion, so your mind is already programmed. Like, that's the only song that should be sung. Mm-hmm. There are 1 billion, 1 trillion songs that you can pick from and still sing and to minister to people.
Yeah.
Please, music ministers, I want us to see the opportunity of leading worship as a very, very serious opportunity and don't abuse it. If you have 5 minutes, make the most of your five minutes so that somebody's life is transformed and somebody is blessed.
Mm.
See it always as an opportunity to be a blessing, as an opportunity to bring down the presence of God through the help of the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
Don't do it casually and say, after all, it's 2 minutes, I give him, or it's 1 minute. Mm. No. At every time, we should be ready soldiers, prepared. When they just say, oh, yeah, we don't ready like this. Please, let's not trivialize this. Let's not casualize it. Some of us complain that our pastors, our church, they don't recognize us. They don't recognize our anointing and what have you. My dear brother, my dear sister, keep doing what you are doing. If you are doing it and they are seeing your work and they are seeing what God is doing through you. My dear, they will start recognizing. Even if they don't recognize it, when outsiders begin to recognize you, they will call you and say, this is our own.
Mm,
but if you don't have anything to give and you're always doing it anyhow, because you say, after all, the church don't appreciate anybody, they don't appreciate us. My dear, you remain where you are because they will keep bringing the outsiders to keep doing it and you will not go anywhere. So any opportunity you get, like I said, if you are a music minister and you don't have a church, you don't have a pastor, that is pastoring you, you don't have a spiritual mentor, you are a
vagabond.
So go and get a church, be under a ministry and be under the ministration of a pastor or a spiritual authority, and God will guide you and teach you in the way that you should go. But if you know griot, you go day where you did.
Pastor Vashti, God bless you. Now, in conclusion, this is what I want you to do. We are talking about the power of spontaneous worship. Please sell spontaneous worship to music ministers. There are people that are on the side of planned and rehearsed worship, and there are some people that are on the side of spontaneous worship. I know which side that you're on. Now you have 2 minutes to sell spontaneous worship to music ministers. Over to
all right. I would like to tell you that there is so much that you get from spontaneous worship. So much. You know, especially, first of all, in your closet. Just you and God. You know, most times you are only, you said 2 minutes, God will help me. Most times we are only concerned about, we are going to lead people. How about you and God, just the two of you? You understand? So that's why you see that in our worship altars, our personal worship altars, the oil, in fact, there's no oil again. It's rusty. But in the church own, plenty of Ororo Day. But where
it's,
we
it's,
need...
It's not the personal worship that we used to see on Instagram everywhere now. We used to see clips
leave, of leave that one.
So why are the personal worship? Mm-hmm. There cannot be camera with you.
No. It's you and God. It's you and God. When I'm having an intimate...
Yes.
It's just like a husband and wife having an intimacy.
Yeah,
they don't bring camera. They don't call anybody. So I am the bride of Christ.
Word.
So I am in intimacy. I'm having an intimacy with my lover.
True.
Why should I now have camera
True.
Around?
True.
Do you understand?
True.
If I do in the worship altar,
yes,
where
yes.
is everybody is there, fine. I can get short please and do.
Yes.
But it's my altar
yeah.
with my lover.
Yeah. Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah.
When Joseph said, leave me at the altar with my father, it's him and his father.
Between him and God.
Yes, between we and God. Mm. So please, don't let your personal worship altar be rusty. Please, let it not be rusty. Ensure that there is oil every time. By the time you go out, whether they call you and say, hey, Margaret, come and sing worship, you are going with confidence because you know where you are coming from.
Yeah.
If you don't know where you are coming from, my dear, you will hit rock bottom like this. Devil will use you and play football. So I invite you to join the spontaneous gang. I'm not saying don't rehearse. If you like, don't rehearse. Your music minister, your director will deal with you. But join the spontaneous team. Spend time in worship to God. Not because you want to lead people in worship, but because you want to have a time of fellowship with your Father. Mm. And you know one thing about spontaneous worship? It helps you to pray.
Mm.
It helps you to pray because you listen. See, sometimes it's not even you singing. Get some playlist, play it, keep yourself in a room and soak yourself, praying in the Holy Ghost. By the time you come out, you'll know that this person went somewhere and there is an unusual grace upon this person. The Lord will help you. If you don't mind, you can meet me. We can be doing spontaneous together. We can have some worship session. Not with camera, just us. Hey, we don't want camera. We don't want lights, Joshua. We just want to worship God. I can give you venue and we'll do it.
Thank you very much, beautiful. It's been a wonderful discussion.
Very wonderful.
And this discussion, I don't think it's exhaustive. We can talk all day about this. There are lots of things that can come out from this discussion.
Sure.
And we'd like to continue this discussion. Please, just chat us up or in the comment section, ask questions and tell us some things that we do not know about. We like to learn because we know no be say we sabi o.
Exactly.
We like to learn.
Also learn.
It's all the little that we know that we are saying, but we like to learn and improve this.
And if you have arguments about spontaneous worship, bring your arguments.
Bring your arguments.
We will learn to
discuss it. That's how we get better. Thank you very much for joining us. Please subscribe to our channel, our YouTube channel, and also follow us on Instagram and on Facebook. And we really, really love to have you there. We have so much content there
Alone.
That we will love you to please.
It will bless you. It will bless
partake
you.
Partake of the blessing. On the 24th of March, by the special grace of God, we are going to be having the March edition of the
worship altar.
Hallelujah. And the theme is Still Waters. Still Waters. It's an open edition. It's going to be holding at, what's the name of that plaza? Eugratius Plaza in Otaku. Eugratius Plaza in
Eagles
Otaku.
Assembly.
So when you just get to that plaza, any of the security in the plaza, just ask them for Eagles Assembly. Eagles Assembly. It's on, I think, the third floor thereabout. It's going to be an open session. And please, we'd like you to be there to join us. If you're not able to make it there physically, you can follow us live on YouTube and on Facebook. On YouTube is at Worship with Vashti, and on Facebook is at Vashti Femi Indagana. So please just follow us there and put in your comments, follow us in the worship, and I'm telling you, you have a wonderful. Last experience was powerful. This next experience, I'm sure it will be powerfuler. In Jesus' name. So please, we'd like to have you there. And I have good news, good news, good news, good news, good news. That same Sunday, we are releasing a new sound. A new sound by Vashti. And the title
Glory
is
Overflowing.
Please sing song. Think small, small, think small, small, small of that song.
Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. I'm overflowing. I'm overflowing with your grace. That's all.
Na. Go on, just wait. It will be out soon. Please. It's a wonderful song that the Lord dropped into Vashti's
yes.
heart.
Yes. It's very short, and we would like open verses.
Open verse.
So we welcome open verses, welcome covers. We want to add something to the song.
The song has only one verse. And then something that is a chant like the chorus.
Is it a verse? It's only two lines.
Yeah, that's all. So when it's out, please, we'd like you to listen to it and then give us your own version of another verse.
Yes.
Or a rap or a spoken word.
Anything.
Anything you want to add to it, you just give it to us. It's going to be out on Sunday. I'm excited. I've heard it, but I'm still excited about Sunday because it's going to be beautiful. Thank you for joining us. This is the end of the podcast for this month. We'll see you again next month. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for following us. Please press that like button and that bell, that subscribe.
Mm.
Please press it. Press it. And you'll be getting more and more content from us. Thank you very much. God bless you. From Vashti is...
Goodbye and have a blessed
from me is I love you all. Thank you for Joshua. Thank you for... Folu, our original camera girl. Thank you for Fisayo. Thank you for everyone in the house, the production crew. Thank you very much. And on this note, we sign out for this month's edition. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.